And welcome to the virtual worship service here at Bethel Congregational United Church of Christ. Today is a terrific day because we'll be celebrating our graduates, both high school and college graduates. The high school students have been primarily the ones who have put together our worship service, and it will be a real treat for you to hear from them. They've done most of the major components in addition to sharing some of their own thoughts about how Bethel has shaped who they are, who they've become, and who they may yet be by the grace of God. So we are delighted that this is a service highlighting our young people. And the beautiful chancel area that's been so decorated in incredibly unique and creative ways, we have thanks to Kathy Toma and Nancy McPherson for creating this beautiful space. Beth's going to provide some explanation of what these symbols mean.
So the graduates chose the scripture Mykah 6:8 as one of their themes. What does the Lord require of you? To seek justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. So the large banner behind David depicts a door opening to a view of planet Earth. This, along with the globe, symbolized the graduates going out into the larger world. Using newspaper print in the signage and even the front page of the local paper represents the turmoil of current events. This face mask is a tangible reminder of COVID-19's impact on our lives this year. Recently, seeking justice has often taken root via social media with hashtag Black Lives Matter and hashtag Me Too. So we chose to use the hashtag to symbolize that part of the scripture. The heart has been used as a common graphic to represent love on everything from bumper stickers to t-shirts, so using it was a familiar way to evoke love and kindness. And the hands symbolize reaching out as we challenge our graduates to continue to seek justice, love kindness, as they walk humbly with their God into the future. So thanks again, Nancy and Kathy. The chancel looks beautiful.
Now we'll move into our worship with the call to worship featuring our 2020 graduates.
We are the graduates of 2020.
We are young.
We are old.
We are the dreamers and visionaries.
We are the warriors for justice.
We are the peacemakers.
We belong to God.
We are the representation of God's still speaking voice revealed in our world today.
We are an open and affirming congregation welcoming all in God's family, wherever each is in their life's journey.
We are people who make love of God, self, and others our first priority.
Together, in all our beautiful diversity, we are a people on a faith journey where grace abounds.
Rooted in love, set free by grace, compelled to serve.
And now I invite you, if you have a candle nearby, to join me in lighting a candle to once again symbolize and bring to our midst the Spirit of God. Now our opening song is a familiar one, Draw the Circle Wide, which our young people chose because they really loved the message of inclusion.
Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle wide. The still point of the circle, round whom all creation turns. Nothing lost but held forever in God's gracious arms. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side. Let our hearts touch far horizons, so in common. great and small. Let our loving know no borders, faithful to God's call. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle wide. Let the dreams we dream be larger than we ever dreamt before. Let the dream of Christ be in us, open every door. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side.
I'm Jacob Winston. I'm going to be doing the opening prayer. Begin with three deep cleansing breaths representing the Trinity, God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Gracious God, who leads us and guides us on our way, we thank you that in life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have shown us what it means to keep your love at the center of our lives. We confess that in times the rush of things that demand our attention, sometimes the heart of our faith gets lost. Forgive us when we allow other things to get in the way of what really matters. Holy One, refocus our passion on the vision of justice and mercy you have called us to bring to life. Keep us always mindful and aware of your grace so that we don't miss what matters. In the name of the one who gives us the courage to follow the truths you have revealed to us, amen.
Another song that was near and dear to the hearts of those of our young people who went through confirmation, particularly the song Sanctuary, which of course is always representative of a place of quiet and safety.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true.
was a song that we shared with Reverend Jenny Ott and the Lake Oswego students on our retreats for confirmation, and that's one of the reasons we chose it this morning, a beautiful kind of camp confirmation song. Now we'll hear scripture reading, and the scripture was chosen as a result of my making some suggestions, and the students picked these two scriptures.
Hi, my name is Mitch Galvan, and I will be reading the scripture for today. Our readings come from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37, was more commonly known as the parable of the Good Samaritan. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You've answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So, too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to an innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The expert in law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise."
I'm Emily Thornton, and I'll be reading Mykah 6:8, verses 6-8. "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him now with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Would the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told me, O mortal, what is God good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God."
In times of COVID-19, a lot has not gone according to plan. Prom, sports seasons, shows, concerts, graduation, senior trips, you name it. Basically, anything I or anyone else up here was looking forward to was canceled. That was kind of rude, in my opinion. In such a topsy-turvy time, I must confess, keeping the faith has been more difficult than any of us could have anticipated. In fact, as I was reading on a recent NPR article, surveys suggest most people who had been attending church regularly are now following worship services online, but some former churchgoers are not bothering to tune in. Some people report their faith has deepened during the crisis. Others may be drifting away from their religious tradition. So us as teens, and really anyone in this congregation, has faced a choice. To lean back, take a hiatus from church, there's a lot going on, maybe including church that's too much on your plate. And to be honest, will anyone really miss me? I mean, no one's going to be looking at my pew to see if I'm there. Or there's a second, perhaps more difficult choice. We can lean into our faith, trust what we've learned, those around us, and maybe even more importantly, those above us. So in today's sermon, the rest of the graduates and I are going to talk about some of the most compelling reasons as for why we've chosen to lean into our faith in a time where throwing in the towel and giving up seems so enticing. Part of what makes our Bethel experience so special is that we've learned to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. So with that, I'd like to introduce Kelsey Brielle Rundorff, who's going to talk about her experience at Bethel and seeking justice from a social justice perspective.
Hi, my name is Kelsey Brielle Rundorff. Throughout my entire life, I've been involved with social justice projects at Bethel. Some examples of this are Faith Cafe, The Food Cupboard, Family Promise, ESL, Beaverton Homeless Teen Project, and Habitat for Humanity. These projects have shaped me and made me the person I am today. Without them, I wouldn't have developed the skills like leadership, dedication, gratitude, and compassion for everyone. An example of this is when I worked with Abby, a girl whose family was part of Family Promise, an organization of churches that provide overnight housing to homeless families. Over the course of our time together, I learned about her life and befriended her. She told me she was scared of moving homes every week, so I made friendship bracelets for both of us to remember each other. This experience taught me the true meaning of justice work we do at Bethel. Additionally, I'm on the board and the Social Justice Committee at Bethel. On the board, I act as a representative for the youth voice in the Bethel community. And with the Social Justice Committee, I bring a young person's perspective to the table. I am part of both of these because I feel like it is important to not only give back to your community through volunteering, but also to be an active member in shaping the future of Bethel.
Hi, my name is Mitch Galvan, and I'll be talking about love and kindness at Bethel. Over my many years as both a follower and member, I have witnessed and participated in many ways that Bethel has helped give back to a whole community of others who cannot necessarily help themselves. One example of this is Faith Cafe. Faith Cafe is an event Bethel holds every week on every Thursday where the homeless and less fortunate are invited to come and enjoy free food and hospitality. I have volunteered for this on multiple occasions, and I have seen the community grow in a way that is beautiful and truly inspiring. This is related to loving kindness because of the hospitality that Bethel shows. We let them know that we feel for them and we treat them with kindness and an equal human being. This relates to the story of the Good Samaritan because the traveler, the people of the congregation, take time to help those who struggle in their life, and it shows that we're all different, and like the story of the Good Samaritan, it shows that the future has potential. And no matter where we are in life, there's good in the world and good in people who will take time out of their day to help those in need. Another way that Bethel has helped show love and kindness is the food supplied to the congregation and community, such as the pancake breakfast and numerous potato bars we put on. This is a good way of showing love and kindness to the congregation because it invites conversation and creates connection through said love and kindness. This relates to the story of the Good Samaritan because there may be people like the old Samaritan and the Jews who hated each other, but there are also those who can look past what they've done and everything that's happened and find a way to find out that they're not very bad people. Whether that be helping a beaten man on the side of the road or over some homemade pancakes and potatoes. But even Bethel needs to receive some love and kindness in the process. One way Bethel has received love and kindness is Grubby Sunday. Grubby Sunday is an annual event that the church holds where after the potato bar, members of the congregation all go out and clean the church both inside and out. My grandpa and I would always take washing the windows, and that's something we connected on, and that was a good way of showing love and kindness to each other and the congregation at the same time. The next hitch much closer for me, because one way that Bethel has shown love to kindness and me is straight up giving us money to fly out to places like Hawaii to attend the WRYE. It shows that like the Good Samaritan, anyone can help those who may need it. In our case, we were trying to get something that we wanted to get to, like Hawaii. Another way they've showed us love and kindness is the times the teen have just been straight up able to use the church for anything that they really needed to, whether that be discussions in the room over there or lock-ins that we all share and connect with love and kindness. Overall, Bethel has shown me how love and kindness is supposed to be and how it's supposed to act, and has made me a better person. It showed me that love and kindness can be harder to show than neglect and anger, but sometimes it's the better option.
All right, I'm going to break this into three parts. So first, let's talk about walking at church, of course. Some of my first memories at this church were of being an acolyte, and I'm sure I can speak for any kid growing up at Bethel in that acolyting is the beginning of our involvement in the service. I remember thinking of it as a big responsibility as a kid. Oh, better not mess up. Am I walking too fast? Too slow? What if my flame runs out? You know, important stuff. Little did I know, there's actually a lot of symbolism associated with walking the flame into worship and lighting the candles every Sunday. So the word acolyte is from the Greek word akoluthos, which is comprised of a, meaning together with, and koluthos, meaning a way, a road, a journey. And I thought that was pretty neat, considering the fact that worship service always starts with people walking down a path towards two candles, symbolizing Jesus' humanity and divinity. In my opinion, it's a really special tradition because it symbolizes how we're always walking with God and reminds us that when we worship, we're bringing his light among us. A big part of the church experience is knowing that wherever you go, you won't be walking alone. Whether that's with your peers, your mentors, or even strangers, you're not alone. Even when you're walking by yourself, it's important to realize that God's always with you. In my experience at Bethel, I've participated in all kinds of activities centered around walking together. On the left is a picture of the table runner we made at one of our confirmation retreats. We worked together to support each other as we tried not to slip in the paint, and together we made a beautiful piece of art. And then on the other side, there's a picture of Diana Marsden and I trying to coach Pastor David as he walked through an obstacle course blindfolded. Walking blindfolded is no easy task, and it certainly made me appreciate my sight. I think it was a humbling experience because it forced us to be completely vulnerable and trusting of one another to lead the way. We bumped into things, got turned around, and even fell once in a while, but I think that's a great metaphor for anyone's journey with God. Coronavirus has been bumpy, winding, and full of surprises, and it's completely changed the way I live my life and forced me to reassess my priorities. If anything, the current pandemic has been one of the most humbling experiences of my life, resulting in me reevaluating my relationships and truly prioritizing the ones I care about most. Add on the recent headlines on the not-so-new topic of racism in the United States, and I see a picture full of privilege. I have so many blessings and so many things I've taken for granted. Coronavirus and the Black Lives Matter movement have truly humbled me as I've learned about the experiences of others in my community and around the country. Walking humbly is difficult, but every once in a while we're blessed with the opportunity to realize just how good we have it, and to not only appreciate it, but also encourage us to share our blessings with others. This is that moment. Which brings us to the last section of the phrase. I've talked about walking and humility, so let's talk a little bit about with your God. Now, as a side note, when it says your God, in my opinion, it's not an exclusive term. It's not just a private term for only me and my particular brand of church, so to speak. Your just indicates the entity you belong to, like your church or your community. So how has Bethel impacted the way I walk with God? Bethel's had a huge effect on my faith journey, and I'm willing to guess it has had a pretty big impact on yours as well. Through my time at Bethel, I've come to realize that God is with us always. Sometimes it's hard to see, and other times it's much more obvious. Sometimes God reveals himself through nature and beauty and literature, and sometimes it's through others like family members, friends, peers, and strangers. The most important part of this message is that you can always walk with God. No matter how far off the beaten path you've wandered, you will always be welcomed back with open arms. Which is why I'm trying, some days more successfully than others, to lean into my church in times of struggle. In the midst of a pandemic and a massive movement, it's easy to get lost in the hubbub and at times even wonder where God is in all this. Surely God wouldn't abandon us. And I assure you, he has not. Sometimes you just gotta look a little harder and take every opportunity you have for growth and be grateful for that. Above all, always know that no matter the circumstances, you can always choose to walk humbly with your God.
I'm Emily and I'll be doing the recap of what we just learned. We have learned that Mykah was right, and what does the Lord require of you? To do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. My takeaways at Bethel are, At Bethel, I have made some amazing memories, from helping at worship to participating in Pride. I'll never forget those memories at Bethel. I've also made some great relationships with my friends and mentors like Nancy Hilbert, Ken, Pam, and Beth. Overall, it's been really great, so thank you.
Throughout my time at Bethel, I've made a lot of great memories, but my most treasured ones are all the volunteer work I've done with my Nana. Growing up with the opportunities I had to give back has instilled a sense of volunteerism in me that I will hold for the rest of my life. Because of my lifetime involvement in the Bethel community, I finally made the decision to become a full member last year. I will always remember how loved and supported I felt as I went through the process of becoming a member. Everyone welcomed me with open arms. Additionally, watching the choir performance every Christmas service through the years made me realize that I wanted to be a part of it. Of course, I had to dress for the occasion in all of my Mickey sweater attire. This was a perfect example of how Bethel let me express myself in my own quirky ways. Another really important part of my time at Bethel has been the relationships I've made. Besides becoming closer to my Nana and God, I also became closer with the people that have inspired me, like Diane, Imel, and Esther. Diane's nickname for me is Sweet Girl, and we always try to check in during coffee hour. I only knew Esther for the last few years of her life, but I learned so many valuable life lessons from her in the short time I knew her. Every week, I would clean her house, but this wasn't a normal cleaning job. She was very particular about how she wanted things done. Special vacuums and special supplies were the norm. So I think one of the biggest things I learned was how to get the job done right. And if it wasn't done right, she would tell me and I would do it again until it was right. My Grandpa John was the same way, always doing things right. And although I never got to know him personally, he lives through me in my connection to Bethel and the choir. Every time the Zimbelsterns play, it brings tears to my whole family's eyes. These people in the community as a whole are the reason I'm committed to Bethel and hope to be a lifetime member. So thank you to everyone who has seen me grow up. Thank you to everyone I have been able to build a relationship with and be able to be myself around. You are all my family, and I can't wait to start my next chapter with all of you by my side. No matter what my future holds, Bethel will always be there, and I will be there for Bethel. It has shaped me into the person I am now, and I am thankful to be able to have a community that I can be myself around and feel like I'm a part of.
Hi, my name is Mitch Galvan, again, and I will be telling you what Bethel has taught me. Bethel has taught me a number of things. Bethel has taught me kindness. And it showed me that receiving kindness is often one of the best feelings of your life. It's taught me love. It's taught me how to love genuinely and 100%. Bethel has taught me to love myself too. Bethel has taught me confidence. And Bethel has taught me to be a better person. It's taught me to reach out to people in need and that we're all different and we've all been on our own ride. And then we all have different experiences, and we're all going to end up in a different place. Bethel has taught me how to connect with people, and has taught me the significance of those connections and my loved ones. It's taught me to treasure them, and it's taught me that I have things to lose. It's taught me that having something to lose is what makes life worth living. It's taught me to be my best self, and to give nothing but my best all the time. Bethel has become a second home to me, and is a place that I will never forget. And it's a place I will leave a piece of my heart at.
Thank you for all the opportunities that this church has made possible for me. From Camp Adams to Rye, I've been able to do some pretty awesome things and will always have some amazing memories. Most of all, I've met some truly incredible people and made some lifelong friendships, many of which are people I would have never met if not for Bethel. Bethel has taught me a lot, from Sunday school to youth outings, from Christmas pageants to Easter egg hunts, from confirmation to OWL to graduation. I can't thank everyone enough for supporting me here at Bethel. This church has given me some of the best mentors and role models imaginable, along with some lifelong friends and an unbreakable family bond.
Well, when I was here Tuesday night when we were filming the students, I was just overwhelmed again with the way in which Bethel provides a home and a community for people of all ages. And the thing that I just thought of as I heard them speak again is that the name of our church, Bethel, means house of God. And we've learned through this pandemic that we can be in God's house, even if it means we're geographically dispersed. And the testimony and the witness and the sharing of stories by these young people just reaffirms that. And I am so grateful that their parents and grandparents have made it a priority for them to participate in the life of the church. And when I hear them speak, I said to the parents and grandparents who were gathered Tuesday night, when I hear the influence that this church has had on young people, it almost gives me permission to say, okay, I could die now. I've done my job. I don't have any plans for that, but it's the sense of wow, we have made a difference, and they will continue to make a difference in our lives and in the larger world in which they'll live. So to me, this is just a terrific day, and I'll say more about it during the announcements, but hope that you'll make your way over here for our actual live connection with our graduates for our parade, our car parade. So I'll look forward to seeing you, and that's why I'm sitting here and the students aren't here, as we did the taping earlier this week. And so now we're going to hear them actually sing. This is a musical rendition of the text. And this was another song that we learned while we were on confirmation retreats. What does the Lord require of you? One of the things that the Lord has required of us that we've carried a tradition for a number of years, and I believe it was George and Liz Patch that brought the prayer shawl ministry to Bethel, and it has been embraced by our congregation as a way of giving tender, loving care to people who might be either going through difficult times or who are going through important transition times. So we're going to have a video showing the graduates receiving their prayer shawls, which we did on Tuesday night.
The prayer of blessing.
May God's grace be upon this shawl, warming and comforting, enfolding and embracing.
May this mantle be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing, in good times as well as difficult ones.
May the one who receives this shawl be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced with peace, and wrapped in love.
Blessed be.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord...
Yeah, just in case you missed the caption, Mitch Galvan received a prayer shawl last year, and we wanted to at least virtually give him a prayer shawl to mark this important juncture in his life and this transition. We're going to enter into a time of prayer now, and there'll be opportunity. I will, as I usually do, offer up particular prayers of petition. I'll offer a pastoral prayer, and then we can join together with the Lord's Prayer. So let us be at a time of prayer together. Holy God, we give you thanks for the beauty of this day, for the reminder that you create order out of chaos, that the sun rises and the sun sets, that your creative spirit is with us each and every day and each and every moment, that with the changing seasons, you remind us that change can bring life, and that the cycle of life and death and life always continues, and that you are the God of this life and of life that we can't even comprehend, that goes beyond what we know here and now. We thank you for the families that make up the Bethel community. And in particular, we ask your blessing on our graduates that are making that important step from what they've known into the unknown. We celebrate their courage and their creativity during the pandemic as they've had to adjust the end of their school year and all of the usual ceremonies and rituals that go along with it. May they know that they are as cherished and loved and blessed as any other graduating class, and that their strength of character will grow and their faith will deepen as a result of coming into an awareness of the challenges of life, because we don't know what's coming, nor can we control it. So it's a time of letting go and leaning into faith. We take a moment now to think of particular people, particular situations that that call for the Spirit of God to be present in them and among them. So we take a moment to lift up those people who are in need of healing, whether it be healing of the body, the spirit, the emotions, the soul. We lift up Wayne and Barbara Hess, Jody Imel, her husband Bob, their daughters, and Jody's mom, Diane. Are there others who are struggling with illness for whom we should pray? Holy God, we take a moment to acknowledge and to lift up the courage and bravery of those people who are peacefully demonstrating in the streets, lifting up the reality of racial injustice, calling us to be more of who Mykah asked us to be. In the sequence of do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God, let us be mindful of justice coming first and equip us to do what we can in our own way to be a part of a new day, a new creation, to use Paul's language in his epistles. Help us to be people that are part of healing solutions. Give us patience and kindness. Help us to speak our truth to power and to be allies to those who have been pushed aside and mistreated by our systems of the economy, politics, business, most of the major institutions, oh God, have favored some and disadvantaged others. Open our hearts and our minds to be your will and way in the world. And Holy God, we take a moment to pray for ourselves, where we are in our homes, help us to hold fast to the sacrifices we need to make for the well-being of all the people, for the public health in the midst of COVID-19. Some of us are beginning to feel the fatigue of COVID-19. We'd like to forget all of the restrictions and just go about our lives the way we did before. And yet we know we need to continue to live with caution, which is not the same thing as fear, to live with caution, to protect the most vulnerable. We pray for our national leaders. May they be broken open by your wisdom and your love and your guidance and compassion Holy God, we believe that you hear our prayers. And we trust that you address them with your steadfast love and wisdom that goes far beyond our imaginations. So gather us now, O God, with that ancient prayer that Jesus' first followers came to him at one point and say, Rabbi, teach us to pray. And he offered this prayer. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The final song that we're going to share to get today is one that I used to play with a bluegrass band, Down to the River to Pray. It's a wonderful, soulful song, and it reminds us of the importance of prayer and location and water, which are so many important symbols in the life of the church. Let us hear Down to the River to Pray.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear that robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sister, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sister, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brother, let's go down, come on down. Let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, mother, let's go down, come on. Let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, Father, let's go down, let's go down.
Now, my friends, may the love of God, the power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, which was given to us on Pentecost Sunday and which we celebrate throughout this season of Pentecost, may our triune God keep you, preserve you, challenge you, equip you for the living of your lives. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
We're going to switch gears now and share several announcements. First of all, a huge thank you to everyone who made Graduation Sunday happen, to the Faith Development Committee for organizing the parade and the decorations, and to the parents and families of our graduates, to our graduates, for their courage to press on and their willingness to create a worship service. And a big special thank you to Stan Davis, who spent countless hours putting together the video from multiple clips and sound bites. And a big thank you to Beth Astarte for pulling all this together and making our graduates know how important they are to Bethel, to her, and to our staff.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these sunken eyes and learn to see your life. You were only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly into the light of the dark black night. Singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise.